Priyanka, is he not joining us? Okay, admin, are you ready? Admin?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Maxinan?
Yeah, we can start.
Madam Urvashi, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay, Supla, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Yes. Good morning, dear learned participants. I don't know what to say, the final day. We are really excited. And we are elated. Such a way we respect you and honor you, because such a way you honored our invitation. And you traveled all the way for the last 1 week. We are extremely happy. At the same time, we are very thankful to you all. Today is the last day. We have two sessions. They're going to be delivered by eminent personalities. Madam is very much available here. And we are also going to witness another beautiful session, both in the morning and evening. Now, to moderate this session, we requested Dr. Subala Pandirajan. She is an assistant professor from the Department of English, University of Madras. She has put in 15 years of experience. She is specialized in teaching Australian studies in India. Then she is specialized in communicative skills, post-colonial studies. And she is also a research supervisor and four candidates are pursuing research under her able guidance. It's our pleasure and honor to introduce and invite Madam Subala Pandirajan to moderate the session. I officially invite her to moderate the morning session. And also, I'm extremely happy to introduce, Madam will officially introduce Urvashi Kausal. And this juncture, I extend a warm welcome to our resource person, Urvashi Kausal, Madam, also. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And a very good morning to all of you. I first thank my dear professors, Dr. Ramasubu, Dr. Marx, and Dr. Armstrong for giving me this opportunity, not just to moderate, but to also get introduced to a wonderful, vibrant personality like Dr. Kausal. Thank you so much. So, officially introducing ma'am, Dr. Urvashi Kausal is a faculty at the Department of English, Sardar Vallabhai Institute, National Institute of Technology at Surat. With over 16 years of teaching experience at the institute, she has also been coordinating courses on communication and research for scholars and students at her institute. She is also in charge of UG teaching of English and communication skills at IIT Surat. She is conferred with a doctoral degree for her work on Shashi Deshpande's novels. Actually, her PhD thesis is on tradition, revolt, and affirmation in the novels of Shashi Deshpande. And her areas of interest include Indian English fiction, post-colonial fiction, and communication skills. Diaspora literature has been a favorite area wherein most of her research scholars, most of her scholars working with her, they have opted to work on diaspora studies. So listing out her publications over a few years, I mean, right from 2004 till date, it reveals that she's such a meticulous personality. And she has 39 publications in refereed and scholarly journals. To name a few, she has published both on literature and language in the international journals like the Commonwealth Review, Journal of Advanced Research in Social Sciences and Humanities, International Journal of Communications, and so on. She has presented papers at several national and international conferences and has been invited as a guest speaker at different forums. And it is at this juncture that, something strikes you in her bio note that she has been pursuing two different areas. One is her passion for literature, and she has also been doing a very genuine service to what she's been teaching, her profession. So that is literature and language. So usually these two tend to bifurcate, and English language departments always have something to disagree with the literary studies department. But then she's able to pursue both her literary interests and also to teach areas like communication studies. So this was very striking when I read her bio note. Most of her papers, she has, whatever she has presented at national and international conferences, she has made it a point to make presentations on literary themes. And she has been invited to deliver lectures on communication skills, employability skills in English, because she is associated to the National Institute of Technology. But she has balanced, she's maintained a very good fine balance between both language and literature, is what I should say. And she is a life member of many important national and international organizations like Association for Indian Association for Commonwealth Studies. She's also a life member of ELTA, English Language Teachers Association of India. So maybe this displacement from your from literature maybe makes you feel interested more in diaspora, and she would be talking on the title for today is Displacement to Double Displacement, Revisiting Diaspora Literature. Of course, like ma'am, most of us would have experienced this displacement some point or the other lives. I just remembered, just when this when I saw this title, I remembered a Vietnamese poet. The poem is about an accident. It is a metaphor where accident is compared to migration. So there's a car which is racing on the road, and the driver thinks at the bend of the road he is going to turn and he's going to go over a bridge. On the other hand, there is no bridge. So the driver does not stop control, but turns with all speed. And instead of a bridge, there is ocean. There's the waters are opening out, and the car, submerges and along with the person. So when this person is washed ashore, he finds himself in a new land. Okay. So, but there is an old cultural self on a new land. So I always feel this poem kind of fixes the essence of diaspora. Nice. And we are able to relate to this poem because every person at some point in our lives would have faced this kind of displacement. So I'm very happy to have introduced you. I have not done justice, but then I'm very happy to have introduced you, and will be more happy to listen to you too. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Supla, for such a kind introduction. I don't think you could have put it in any better way than how you talked about me. All right. Rather, I think you gave a very positive note to my entire journey as a teacher. As a person teaching in NIT, I have to teach communication skills, but my love is always in literature. So, like you truly said, I am a person like the true diasporas. I am also displaced. I live here and think there. Okay, so I teach communication skills, but I always think about literature and literary works. And having said that, I would once again say, and yesterday also I think I said it, that I envy all of you. I envy all the people who are reading and teaching literature. try and understand my position. I have just one play to teach, that too to a class of MSc students, okay, where I teach Tughlaq to Girish Karnad's Tughlaq, and I look forward to it because that's like a little respite I get from teaching communication skills. Although I feel there is a lot of merit there also in teaching communication skills, but when there is a platform like this of literature, I envy all of you. I envy the flow of ideas that comes naturally to you all because you've been speaking, teaching to MA classes. I wish I get an opportunity like that someday to teach like you all have. Okay, having said that, thank you so much. Thank you for inviting me. First of all, I would begin by thanking the University of Madras, MTNC Mannar, Mother Teresa Women's University Kodaikanal, Society of Literature and Culture, to have organized such an incredible event where I think people across the country who have a passion for literature and also language would love to listen to this. And what could be a better time than this, than all of us are stuck and we can't think of as to what to do these days. And I from what I hear and what I've seen, I see a lot of dignitaries also present here today. And if not, I'm sure some of them may be busy, but I would like to thank them. I'll begin by thanking Dr. Perumala Swami, Pro Vice Chancellor of Nurul Islam University. Thank you, sir, for providing me this platform, and thank you for sparing time to join us today. Okay, I hope I'll be able to do some justice to to the event that you all have put hard work and have organized. I'm also grateful to Secretary of MTNC Mannar College, that is Mr. Vijay Raghavan, who was kind enough to extend a second invitation to me in their program, another program where I was given an opportunity to speak. I'm grateful to him for remembering and giving me a second chance also. And I look forward to meeting a scholar like Professor Armstrong from University of Madras, who's also heading the Department of English. I hope he's here today. If not, I still convey my regards to him, because it is people like him that we look up to when we talk about literature in India and how it is being taught. And I thank Professor Marx also for joining here today from Pondicherry University. Sir, I want to listen to you because I'm sure that there's a lot in your talk from which I can learn and add to the knowledge that I have. Okay, and sir, please do feel free to tell me where I have missed something, because treat me as a junior and I hope that you will be able to tell me, what all to incorporate in the talk that I have today. I see that we are almost in the same line, okay, and I hope that you will be kind enough to guide me in any of the things that I have missed. I am also grateful that Dr. Jayapriya is here. She was she was kind enough to interact with me yesterday also. And Dr. Meena, Dr. Vimla from MTNC, who have always been kind to talk to me and help me out. And more than anybody else, I think I need to thank Dr. Ramasubhaiya for always remembering me. I call him Anna now because he is, he's like a brother who always thinks that I'll be able to speak on a platform like this. Thank you so much. Thank you for being so, having so much faith and confidence in me. It gives me immense confidence that you think so highly of me. Thank you so much, sir. And Dr. Supla for her kind words. I look forward to interacting more, with you. And I hope that someday we will meet and I want to read what you have been working on. It's very interesting because Australian literature I have not trapped, but it seems that you have a very good, background of it. So looking forward to reading a lot from you and listening to you, Dr. Supla. And last but not the least, I thank the admin, Sudhakar, for always helping me out with the technical problems that I face. Okay, thank you, Sudhakar. And I hope that today's session also will go ahead without any glitches. And I hope I don't make any mistakes. And if I do, I am sure you are there to help me out with it. Okay, thank you so much. And, I think sir is there, Professor Perumbala Swami is there.
Yes, he is here.
Thank you so much, sir, for being here and for taking time out to listen to this. Okay, I hope I'll not interrupt your schedule or anything. I'll just take some time. Shall I begin now?
Sir, madam, sir is here. Okay. Perumbala Swami, sir is here.
Yes.
Yes.
Hello, sir. Good morning, sir.
Thank you, madam. We enjoyed our talk. We are very happy to hear, to listen to our talk.
Thank you so much. Thank you, madam, for the opportunity, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
We wish you a bright, madam.
Yes, sir.
Madam.
Yes, sir.
I wish you a bright and fruitful future, which will be cherished by you in the long run.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. It's a blessing and I'll cherish it.
That you have taken Ramasubha as your brother. He is my disciple and he is also here on the function.
Yes, I can see that.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Very, very kind.
Kind of you. All right. Shall I begin? Yes, I think we have enough participants and we can begin.
Yes, ma'am. We have 350 participants.
Yes, that's great.
And they will join. They will join in the course of time. We'll have around 500 participants.
Okay. That's a huge number. Even 300 plus is a huge number to address. So once again, thank you for the opportunity. All right. Because I think my talk is a little lengthy, without wasting much time, I think I'll proceed with it. All right.
Put it in slide mode.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you. First slide.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Now we are going to talk about displacement to double displacement. I heard a little bit of Professor Kanan's talk yesterday where he talked about diaspora. Okay, whatever he discussed in diaspora, I hope that I'll be able to add a little more to it, and we'll be able to develop a proper discourse on diaspora and how it has progressed. Okay, we begin with the term. Before I even start with the term, let me tell the audience today that in this 1.5 hour or 1 hour 15 minutes talk that I have today, I intend to cover the background of the term and the area that is of study, diaspora as an area of study. From there, I would like to move towards the characteristics of diaspora, then some writers who have written from diaspora, and then we move towards the characteristics of the literature that they have produced, and from there I would like to move towards the actual point of focus of my topic, that is double diaspora and the list of authors that is there, the traits in their writings, and double displacement that we see today. Okay, now Let us begin from the genesis of the term diaspora. The term diaspora came into being because of Jews who were scattered across the globe, and it goes back to the Babylonian time and the Roman Catholic destruction of Jerusalem, and how Jewish population was dispersed across the globe. They were they had no opportunity but to move out of their homeland and make home in different places of the world. Now, to think about the term etymologically, we can understand that it comes from the Greek term di and sparian, which means to scatter. To scatter, it is considered, or the connotation tells us that it is scattering of seeds. And that is what has happened with the Jewish population. I go back to the first sentence in the slide. where Bill Ashcroft, in his post-colonial studies reader, says that it is a term of growing relevance in post-colonial studies. But then we've seen that since 1990 onwards, this term has continuously gained currency, and it has modified, and the term diaspora has led to many new angles that are being probed and are studied, not just in the field of literature, but in sociology, economics, and many, many other fields. But coming back to the term and coming back to how it was created, the term embodies a notion that is that there has to be a center, a locus, a home from where the dispersion occurs. Now, people, whether we talk about the Jewish population as, and how it, you know, it all started, to today, how the term has broadened and it encompasses, you know, anybody who's migrated from their homeland to another country, we understand that diaspora, whenever we talk about it, requires a center, a locus, a home from where dispersion occurs. I will begin with, Edward Said's, notion of diaspora, where at the time he talked about it, as synonymous to exile. And he said that exile is an unhealable rift forced between a human being and a native place, between self and its true home. When Said talked about diaspora or exile, he meant that, in his essay, The Mind of Winter, he said that it is like, a person has been uprooted, the person has been removed, he's cut off from his roots and his land and his past. Okay, so Edward Said talked about it in terms of exile, and for him it meant that exile is never a state of being satisfied, placid, or secure. Okay, he thought or he felt that exile was a situation where the person is never satisfied, never secured in his in this place, and he always has two things to remember. From there, I would like to move towards, William Safran's definition of diaspora. It all started, if we go back as to how this whole area of study came into being, we see that that in 1991, a very important journal came into being, that is Diaspora, a journal of transnational studies. And in volume one and issue one, there was this very important, a seminal essay by William Safran, who in his essay, Diasporas in Modern Societies, Myths of Homeland and Return, felt that the term diaspora was being misused. And he said that the term is being now used for expatriates, expellees, political refugees, alien residents, immigrants, ethnic, racial minorities. He felt that it was being used as a metaphor to describe people of various communities. But he gave us a very clear idea as to how diaspora, a community was created. And he gave some very clear features of it, where he said that originally the term diaspora was used for a community that had moved from its homeland to two or more countries, and they were bound by a geographical location, by a common vision, a memory or myth of their homeland. He told us clearly that diaspora was a community that had although spread in different countries, they kept some memory, some vision of their homeland, and they tried to remember it. And he also stated very clearly that diaspora, according to Safran in 1991, was a community that believed that they will never be accepted by the host societies. He said that host societies, no matter how welcoming they were, diasporas felt that they would not be accepted clearly. And therefore, they started developing their own autonomous culture and social needs in that small group that they lived in another land. And these people also felt that someday they or their descendants will be able to return home. Okay, so this whole notion still comes out from the Jewish concept, where the Jews felt that they would be able to go back to their homeland someday when the situation would be favorable. And for this reason, they continued maintaining a communal consciousness and solidarity in their activities, and trying to remember and trying to practice the traditions and cultures of their homeland. But then from 1991 to when we come to 2000, I'm jumping a decade here, but to come to my actual topic in 1.5 hour, I am sorry I'm doing this, but then we need to understand that the shift came in 2000 with Robin Cohen and Avtar Bra and others, who started expanding the meaning of the term diaspora and diasporic community. They said that it isn't essentially a group of people who have been exiled and who have been forced to leave their homeland. They expand the term, and like I have these 5 points here, which I've taken from Cartographies of Diaspora, written by Avtar Bra. She has very clearly stated that there are 5 different reasons why diasporas are formed. She starts with conquest and colonialism, where she says that because of various conquest and colonialism, there were people who had to leave their homeland and shift to another land that was probably that was more peaceful, and where they could, they felt that they could have an easy and happy life. So we had one reason, that is conquest and colonialism. The other reason was capture and removal of a group through slavery or indentured labor. The other reason that we see in the beginning of the 19th century, that is around 1830s or so, we saw there were slaves, or even before that, people from Africa were captured and sent to various colonies of these colonizers as slaves to do some labor work. And in the beginning of the 19th century, we saw indentured labor, a system coming up where once again people were removed from their homeland and were made to settle in a land where they had to work as indentured labor. A third reason for diaspora formation is when people are, because of political strife, are forced to flee their homeland. And I think this is happening even today, where you have Rohingyas or you have the Syrians leaving their homeland to find a better place. Same is when there is war and conflict, like we saw in Sri Lanka, and how people had to move out of their homeland and settle in various places simply to have a more peaceful and safe and secure life. But then the last category is what became a major trend for diaspora formation in the late 20th century. We saw how most of the Indians have moved to America or to various European countries for better jobs, and how these countries had also welcomed them and had invited them because they needed proper skilled or unskilled labor, or maybe trained professionals to somehow upgrade their economy. So as Avtar Bra has expanded the term, we see the diaspora today is not just limited to people who are exiled, who are banished from their homeland, but it encompasses a whole lot of other people who have moved away from their homeland. But then coming back to what Avtar Bra states, I would say that it is not just limited to migration. It is also about the notion of a journey that takes you elsewhere and makes you root yourself in another land. So apart from the concept of home or migrating from the home, diaspora also it has to be studied with the notion of a journey that has taken place. And then today, like we see that this term has been, is used for a number of racial groups living in different countries. But then essentially what it means is that it is a combination of migration and continued cultural affiliation to the homeland. So what we understand from the term diaspora today is that it is used for any racial group, a group of people who are living away from their homeland. But then, you know, after their migration somewhere, they have tried to continue their cultural affiliation with the homeland and with the, you know, the culture or culture to which they essentially belong. Now, I come back to another very important work that is by Robin Cohen, that is Global Diasporas and Introduction, where he's tried to once again describe diaspora, and he says that it's diasporas as communities of people living together in one country who acknowledge that old country, a notion often buried deep in language, religion, custom, or folklore, always has some claim to their loyalty and emotion. So Cohen insisted that diasporas are a group of people who have moved away from their homeland, but then they are also a group of people who somewhere remember the old country. How? Because there is, through their language, religion, custom, and folklores, that old country has had some claim on their loyalty. So no matter where they go, where they shift, they will always have a certain loyalty towards their homeland. And from there, I move towards another very important theorist in terms of diaspora, that is James Clifford, who has talked about it, and he says that no matter where you take them and how good the environment is, diasporas are people who will not be cured. They will never be able to merge into the new national community. Because of their past, their history of displacement, they will continue to have, they will continue to remember or have an affection towards the homeland. And here he gave a very interesting line, and I think that is worth quoting every time we talk about diaspora or the first group of diaspora, where he said the diaspora cultures thus mediate in a lived tension the experiences of separation and entanglement, and it means that they are a group of people who are living here but remembering and desiring another place. So he gave us a sentence that very effectively describes the essence of diaspora and their whole consciousness. So we understand that these are a group of people who are living here but remembering and desiring another place. But I just talked about how they are people who have migrated from home and how they carry a mental baggage, how they always remember their homeland and therefore would probably not assimilate completely to the host land. But then we also need to remember that diaspora doesn't end just with the first generation of migrant people. It is not as if, diaspora is a community that comes, that is only of people who have migrated and people and their children who are born in that host country, who get the citizenship of that country, would not come into the diaspora community. It is stated very clearly in a number of theories, and we've also seen it in the literature, that the children born in the migrant people also carry this diaspora consciousness because of the influence of the past migration of their parents or grandparents. And like Avtar Bra very rightly says that the whole community has its consciousness that is built by a confluence of narratives of different journeys from old country to the new. So time and again, the children of these people are told about the journey that their father or grandfather had to undergo and how their true homeland is in another country. So therefore, the second generation of the diaspora also carries this whole diaspora consciousness and lives with with an entire a mindset that the homeland is somewhere else, and which hence leads to a kind of homelessness and displacement in them. it's a very common feature of diaspora literature or diaspora consciousness. If we just consider and talk about diaspora people, they carry a kind of homelessness and displacement. Why? Because when they've moved to a new place, they have carried a baggage along with them. It is not just a physical sense of possession or belongings that they carry, but with themselves, they have also carried their beliefs, traditions, customs, behaviors, and values. We see it in diaspora novels and in also in diaspora movies that we have seen, where the Indian culture, be it a small celebration of Karwa Chauth or Diwali or Holi, or all these festivals are celebrated and are continued to be treated as something integral to the life of people settled in another land. So through their customs and traditions, they have carried their tradition. They've carried forward their whole, their essence of being, a native of a land that they have left behind. And when they do so, this whole consciousness does not make them feel at home somewhere. Okay, when they carry the beliefs, the traditions of another country, another society, another culture, it is very difficult for them then to acclimatize, to acculturate themselves in the host society and its culture. And therefore, there is displacement, fragmentation, discontinuity, and the in-between experience that comes into their lives. So why are they displaced? Once again, we can go back and think as to why they are displaced. If a host country is providing them a very conducive environment and is giving them a home to stay and welcomes them, yet these people are not able to consider it as their home. Why? Because home stands for shelter, stability, security, and comfort. And the most of the first generation diaspora people felt that they will return back home. Sometimes, they felt that, all right, after they have maybe, once they have earned enough money, they'll be able to go back home. Or once they have a security, maybe financial security, or once things are better in the homeland, they will be able to go back home. So security, even though provided in the hostland, sometimes they felt that the security of the homeland was much better and they looked back at the homeland more. And then, what is home to us? When somebody asks me who I am, I tell right after my name, I say that I'm an Indian. Okay, so home tells us where we originated from, where we belong, and it gives us a sense of place. It gives us a sense of location as to where we belong to in this entire world. And here I would like to digress a little bit and talk about some humanist geographers who study place and people together, significance of place in people's life. And there we have Tim Creswell, Tuan, and also Edward Relf, Soja, and many other humanist geographers who have time and again since 1975 onwards have written consistently about how important home is to a person's identity. Tim Creswell talked about it and said that place provides the base for people to assert their identity. Unless you know who you are, where you belong to, you'll never be able to assert your identity. And he also said that it is also a way of seeing, knowing, and understanding the world. Okay, you need to know who you are then to understand who others are, who are the others who are living in the other parts of the world. And he said that it adds meaning and experience to a person's life. Knowing the place where he belongs gives meaning and experience to a person's life. And Tuan very, very easily and very effectively, clearly disintegrated, differentiated space and place, and said that that space is a realm without a meaning. Whereas place becomes place becomes something that is meaningful, that gives us an experience, that gives us an identity. And I would also take just half a minute to discuss here Edward Relf's concept of insideness and outsideness. Relf very clearly talked about it and said that insideness means a place where a person can have identity within it, and his identity gets rooted there. He can trace back his, you know, his lineage and find out who his fathers and forefathers were. Whereas outsiders, outsideness means, you know, a place where, you know, you feel alienated and you can't identify with it. So you may live in a place, but yet feel like an outsider. You may yet be treated, you know, you may yet have that feeling of outsideness. Now, moving back again to literature and the literary concept of diaspora. So even though the host countries have provided them a place to stay, yet these people of diaspora communities find home simply as a mythic place of desire in their consciousness. So diasporas do not see the hostland as a home. They see it as a mythic place where someday they will be able to probably go back to, or someday, you know, they will be able to have a connection with. Now, this was a concept in the, you know, in the initial phases of diaspora people and their literature. And gradually, when we, you know, when we talk about Salman Rushdie and others, we see that there is a shift in their understanding of homeland. Like Salman Rushdie, in his seminal work *Imaginary Homelands*, it's a very beautiful essay written about, you know, what a person who's migrated or who's exiled from his homeland and how he thinks and sees his homeland. You understand that Rushdie clearly states that their image or understanding of homeland is a fractured, discontinuous relationship with the present. He very clearly states that these are two things that will never come together. People who are living outside the country have a longing to talk about their homeland, but it will still be a fractured, a fragmented image or understanding of the homeland that they have. And but then, why is it that they need to speak about it again and again? And here we have Kaçık Tolulyan, who is an Armenian-American professor who also contributed to the first issue of Diaspora, the journal, where he said that attachment to a place was indispensable to diasporic life. He says that you cannot take away that attachment, a longing for a place of their own from the diaspora life. It will always be there. Then, you know, in the recent time, we have Robert Cohen, who has once again talked about the issue of home and homeland and how it is, you know, there has been a shift. Home is important for diaspora, but sometimes, like you see in the first generation diaspora, it is like a solid, you know, a solid concept that, you know, that they've always had a kind of longing to look for a homeland somewhere, or a longing to go back to the homeland. But then it sometimes for the second or the third generation, it is sometimes ductile, sometimes it is liquid. It is, you know, so Cohen very easily talks about the concept of homeland and home in diaspora and says that it keeps shifting. It depends upon how the person sees it. But then we cannot forget the fact that even though for the first generation diaspora also, home was an integral concept, a longing that they had for, it was still in fragments, in fissures, in gaps, and in and it was like full of gaps and breaches. So therefore, reflection of home is in pieces only for diaspora people, and a sense of displacement will always remain in their concept. Now, when we talk about diaspora literature, I would begin by discussing a very interesting concept given by Kaçık Tolulyan, who, you know, distinguished diaspora discourses and said that there is epic, emic, and etic diaspora. And he's borrowed these terms from behavioral sciences, and where emic is people who go and do field research. And he says that emic diaspora are a diaspora that talk about themselves, who have experience, who belong to the diaspora community, and who have experienced this whole shift, this whole transition from homeland to another country, and are telling us about it. Whereas ethic diaspora refers to scholarly works of people who are not diaspora community, but who are studying it, who are reading it. like most of us who are who are trying to understand the concept of diaspora. But going back to Emic diaspora and their literature, let us ask a question as to why diasporas write. Okay, why do they have a need to write? Because we see a lot of literature coming out from the Indian diaspora community or the South Asian diaspora community, and it is getting appreciated quite a lot also across the world. You see, whether it is Kabila Shamshi or whether it is the Bangladeshi diaspora writers like Tehmima Anam or Pakistani diaspora writers or Sri Lankan diaspora writers, somewhere they have found a platform, they have a voice, and they are reaching out to the world audience. Whereas somewhere I feel in last decade, the Indian writers have not got a platform as the diaspora writers have received. Now, why is it so? One, we understand the fact that these people, have a need to project themselves, to tell their stories, because their stories are interesting, because there is a lot to be told. They can go back to one or two generations and bring out innumerable stories of shift of, their migration and the trials and tribulations that they experienced or their fathers experienced in this whole process of migration. So therefore, Salman Rushdie also very clearly says that it is also their urge to reclaim their past. Okay, it is one, a need to tell their story to the world. And secondly, it is also, if they talk about their home, it is like they will somewhere be able to identify and reclaim their homeland a little more than what they have been able to do so earlier. So therefore, we see that writers keep writing about diaspora in order to reclaim their homeland. And home is a mental construct built from incomplete odds and ends of memory that have survived the past. Okay, so for home, for them, diaspora, home is a mental concept, and their nostalgia, and together with curious attachments with home tradition, religions, and languages, they have given birth to diaspora literature. The fact that they wanted to talk about it, they wanted to somehow find their roots and find stories to somehow weave and find a kind of clear route to their past, they have been able to create a whole corpus of knowledge that we see as diaspora literature. And here we have writers like Salman Rushdie, V.S. Naipaul, Jhumpa Lahiri, Rohingtan Mistry, Amitabh Ghosh, Bharti Mukherjee, Chitra Banerjee, and many more. And see, I've taken the names of most celebrated, renowned, and writers who have received awards from various quarters. And these are all people who have written, who have given us fiction from foreign shores. And in their fiction, what we find is a sense of yearning for our motherland. There is a disjunction between past, present, here and there. And home seemed far removed in time and space. But then, we also understand that there is always, we as Indians, when we read their literature, sometimes we find that that probably this is simply a part of their imagination. And it is not true to what we see or we understand India as. So there is also a kind of, an imagination that a lot of imaginary things added in their literature. And like I said, that their understanding of homeland is often in fissures and gaps and breaches of knowledge. So therefore, they fill that up with, their imagination and what, Rushdie calls as imaginary homelands. Because what they create, the stories that they create of home is imaginary homeland and not true representation of homeland. And I go back to Edward Said again, and he also said that, diaspora people have an advantage when they become writers. They get an advantage because they have a plurality of vision. Okay, they get to see two cultures. They get to experience two cultures and compare them. And once they are able to compare it, they feel that they have a more objective vision, a more plural vision to the whole thing. And that is his view, where he feels that obviously they then they are able to give a better picture of the situation. similar thing was stated by Salman Rushdie. And I also came across an essay by Hanif Qureshi, a British Pakistani writer, who also states the same thing, where he says that it gives them double perspective. So all these diaspora writers feel that they have an advantage because they are trying to trace their roots in the homeland. They are trying to tell us stories from the homeland, at the same time being an outsider, looking at home from an outsider's perspective. And to tell you very clearly, I can't go into the details of it, but in recent times, there's a lot of research that is being done to question their interpretation of homeland. And there's this very interesting scholar, Lisa Lau, who has talked not once, but again and again as to how this advantage is being commercialized by most of these writers who are, writers and also publishers who are willing to give or publish novels by a diaspora writer more easily than by an Indian author. But that is another discussion, another topic of debate. We can, have maybe another opportunity to discuss it. But coming back to it, why do these diaspora people write and what is the benefit? The first thing is that these people have been writing in order to tell their stories, to project their whole journey to the world. Second thing is that, it is an advantage that they have because they have a kind of double perspective when they write. Now, talking about the features of diaspora, we understand, I have enlisted few and I'm sure there are many more and the audience can also add to a few more later on. We see that, some very integral features of diaspora literature is number one, longing for home, nostalgia that we see. Okay, the second thing is the experience of loss. The fact that they have moved away from their homeland, they feel that they have lost something there. And then the next thing is the marginal feeling, the feeling of dislocation, marginalization that they experience in the hostland. For not all the diaspora community, it has been easy. And it is not as if they have always experienced or have always felt that, they are welcomed and they can easily assimilate with the host society. So they experience marginalization also. It could be because of, their own doing, because of the baggage that they carry. And it could be because of a society that is hostile to that whole group of people. The other thing that we see is memory and their longing or their their continuous dream of homecoming. Okay, so we see that they carry memory of homeland and they keep desiring or having thinking of returning home. And once again, to borrow the phrase or the sentence, that Clifford gave us, diaspora means living here and desiring another place. And what we also see in diaspora literature is a sense of displacement, a sense of uprootedness that we see. Now, having said that, I would go back to a very basic book on postcolonialism. But then I love the sentence that John MacLeod talked about, and where he said that diaspora spaces are dynamic and shifting, and they are open to repeated constructions and reconstructions. So therefore, even though we understand diaspora as people living here and desiring there, we need to understand that it can shift, it can change, like it has changed from the concept that William Safran or Edward Said had to the concept that Avtar Brauer, Robert Cohen presented to Clifford, the concept that Clifford talked about. It is continuously evolving and it is shifting and it is dynamic. And in the end, I would tell the latest as to how once again it has shifted from what I'm talking about and how the present research is taking diaspora in another angle completely. Now, I talked about Indian diaspora. I gave you a list of many writers of Indian diaspora. But then there is And there are other diasporas also. The Indian diaspora and the writers of Indian diaspora that I talked about were basically people settled in these developed countries like England or, you know, in America or in Canada, and had prospered as writers and who were telling stories about India and probably, you know, sometimes the country where they have, you know, they've taken the citizenship also. But then there is this other group also, that is the other diaspora, and we need to understand them to understand the double diaspora and double displacement that it has caused. Now I take the you know, the phrase, the sentence or the point given by Avtar Bra, who said that one of the reasons why diasporas were created was capture and removal of a group of people who were made slaves or indentured laborers around 1830s. So when we talk about the Indo-Caribbean diaspora, we have this whole group of people who were, after this, that abolition of slavery, they were forced or sometimes enticed into moving away from their homeland in the remote areas of Bihar, Bengal, or the eastern states, or Orissa, or the other eastern states of India, and they were either captured, kidnapped, or enticed, and then they were taken to far off places. Now these people were taken to either Caribbean islands, or Mauritius, or British colonies in Guyana, Trinidad, Tobago, French and Dutch colonies of Suriname, St. Lucia, and all these places where they were kept as indentured laborers. Now you have to read the history of it to understand what inhuman conditions these people were kept in and how these people survived. It is another story and a very you know, hair-raising experience that some of the people, you know, those indentured laborers had to go through. And we have an incredible body of literature that is available today that takes us back to two centuries to tell us how these people you know, had this whole experience of migration and how they tried to preserve their culture. Some of you know, they carried Ramayana and they kept you know, repeating the stories in order to remember their culture. Okay, and it's very interesting as to how they moved ahead. But then they realized that after maybe 50 years of settlement or so, and even the second generation and the third generation came up, and they realized that, you know, there was barely an opportunity to go back to India. Sometimes they didn't have the money, sometimes one or two, like Naipaul refers to, you know, a case where a group had returned to India and found that homeland was totally different from what they had remembered. So that fractured memory once again troubles them and stops them from identifying with the home that they thought was a home to, for them. So what we see is that these people, once they were taken to as laborers or as indentured laborers, laborers to various plantation fields of sugar, cocoa, rice, rubber, okay, by the colonizers, they were left there. And even after colonialism came to an end, these people could not return back. Or they decided not to go back home. Why? Because they had acclimatized themselves to the situation there in these places, and somehow they had become landowners and had started, you know, they even had prospered quite a lot. And what we see that post-independence, but after maybe 100 years of settlement in these countries, after 1960s, we see that these Caribbean islands started becoming independent. And once they became independent, there was a lot of political strife and conflict between the indigenous population of that island and also the Indians who had settled there. Now, because the Indians had prospered, had become you know, one of the wealthiest communities, they were targeted by the Africans who were the first settlers of that on those islands, and therefore they felt that Indians were cheating, robbing them of their you know, their rightful wealth. So therefore they were targeted and they were forced to leave these islands. We see once again in 1960s a mass mass exodus of Indians moving out, or Indian settlers, or say descendants of Indian indentured laborers moving out from these islands and moving towards England, Canada, and USA. And we see that these people go to these people to these places, and like we have V.S. Naipaul, who also shifted to for education, and later on also settled in England. Another similar condition we see in Indo-African diaspora. We see that in Indian diaspora, African diaspora also, it was the same history. We see the same thing coming up, where people from the western coast of India were taken as laborers, and they were made to work and lay railroads in East Africa, where there were these British colonies and these railroads were constructed mainly by the Indian laborers who were carried from the western shore of India. So we had another group of people who had settled in Tanzania, Kenya, Uganda. And even afterwards, we saw a lot of people like the Shamshi community that migrated from Gujarat, the shore the coastal areas of Gujarat, to the Eastern African countries, and they settled there for trade purpose and became prosperous businessmen there. Once again, around 100 years, and this Indo-African diaspora community also became a very prosperous community. And after 1960s, we see that when colonialism came to an end, we see that these countries like Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, when they became independent, Indians were considered, Indo-Africans were considered as people who were not welcome there. Most of us have read about Idi Amin and how he had, he had orchestrated the mass exodus of Indians from Uganda. He wanted all Indians to leave Uganda. He forced Indians to leave Uganda. So this is what we see, and it's similar things happened in Kenya and in Tanzania, which led once again for the Indo-African people to then move towards another country. And once again, since they could not identify with India, why? Because they had assimilated somewhere with the African population, they felt it difficult to go back to India, and therefore they looked forward and they moved to developed countries like England, Canada, and USA. And here we have then the writers of these diasporas. These are the other diaspora, or whom we call as people of double diaspora. So in the Indian Indo-Caribbean category, we have V.S. Naipaul, Samuel Selvon, Neil Bisundat, Cyril Debbie Dean, Shani Mathu, Kevin Baldev Singh, Ishmit Khan, Wahid Kapil Dev, Mahadeen Das, Harold Sunny Laddu. Then we have Sashi Narayan Prasad. So we have all these people who have somewhere, Indian origin, but they were born and brought up in Caribbean islands. And they had to somewhere move once again to the other country. So they have experienced not one, but two diaspora, two migration. And therefore, we see the whole concept of double diaspora in their writings. And sadly, from the Indo-African shore, we have few writers. We have the most renowned writer from there we have is M.G. Vasanji, and we also have Jamila Siddiqui and Abraham Varghese, about whom is mentioned in this book, Mythologies of Migration, by Pirbhai. I would like all of you to just take note of the names that is here. Okay, although these people have never, when they started writing, they had never visited India, but yet their names, their identities somewhere tells us about their Indian origin. Like we have, Bisundat, we have Shani Mattu, we have Baldev Singh, We have Hari Sunny Laddu. Okay, Kapil Dev. Even the spelling differs. Even Vasanji. Okay, Vasanji, you'll find the surname very common in Gujarat also today. So you see that the spelling sometimes may be different. The pronunciation may have changed a little bit. But their names tell us the origin of these people and the fact that they come somewhere from India and they are these double diaspora people. The other thing that when we talk about these people, we cannot just talk about them as people who have settled or who have migrated to one place. We need to categorize them differently, and we need to understand these people differently because they have not undergone one migration, it is two migration, and it is two displacement that has changed their whole concept of identity completely. Okay, so we have, like I just said, post 1960s, political instability led to crime, ethnic, cleansing, and where Indians were targeted, therefore displacement, they were forced to flee. And I borrow this sentence from Neil Bisundat's, very interesting short story, Security, where he says, where a character, Mr. Ram Gulam, okay, once again, pay attention to the name Ram Gulam. Okay, the spelling is that Bisundat writes is G-O-O-L-A-M. But what he, the person, once again, is somebody whose grandfather had migrated to the Caribbean island and had established a major business house in the Caribbean island. But the story tells us as to how, when suddenly there is political instability in these islands, this person, Mr. Ram Gulam, is suddenly uprooted. Now, he has not known India. He knows that his grandfather was from India, but he has never visited India. And one fine day, when because of all this instability, his son comes and tells him that they will have to move out overnight from these Caribbean islands that they have seen as home. Mr. Ram Gulam says that putting a lifetime in a suitcase, he thinks that he has to now, and the government doesn't allow them to take any cash or any mobile property with them. So they are not allowed to take anything. So they are asked to only pack up everything they can in one suitcase and leave the country overnight. So Mr. Ram Gulam is at a loss. He says he feels that how can they pack a whole lifetime in a suitcase and leave? So this is the situation of the double diaspora. Okay, your fathers have settled in a country where they have struggled for around half a century, and they've been able to establish themselves. They give you a strong foothold. They establish a business. They make home for you. And after maybe another generation or so, once again, you are uprooted. Once again, you are asked to leave everything and then look for a homeland somewhere else. So after one or two generations of settlement, there is displacement again in these people. But what makes these people, doubly displaced is the fact that they carry a Indian heritage. Their name, their physical features, their tradition, their food habits are mostly Indian. But then they have never visited India. Okay, and especially some of them who, even before they became writers, they were writing about Indian traditions, although it is always a mix of Indian Caribbean or Indian African traditions or culture. But then that Indianness is very commonly there in their writing. And what we also see is that, their language, culture, experiences are mixture of these two countries that they have known. The country that that Indian influence that their fathers or forefathers had integrated or instilled in them, and the Caribbean way or the African way of life, which they had seen because they were born and brought up in these countries. So they have a kind of double consciousness. What they see is they were born and brought up in Little Indias, as Vijay Mishra in his essay calls Little Indias, because their fathers and forefathers had created Little India in the Caribbean island or in, you know, in Africa, African countries where they had settled. They had tried to preserve some of their culture and tradition, and they had time and again told their, you know, their children about it, so that they maintained the, you know, their original identity. So they were born and brought up in these Little Indias, far away from India. And they know, but then what do they know about India? They know about India only through fractured fissures of memory that too conveyed to them by their parents and grandparents. It is not their memory. Salman Rushdie has his own memory. Okay, why? Because he's the first, we can club him into a, put him into a diaspora writer category. Why? Because he had his own memory of India and an imaginary homeland. He talks about a picture that was there in his father's house, which again and again, inspired him to write about India. And he calls that picture the reason why he wrote Midnight's Children. But then what about these writers? Now, they do not have a memory. It is their parents' memory that they have been carrying of a homeland. So India to them is a fractured, fissured memory of something that their parents have told them. And they have preserved their cultures, but have also adapted to new ways of life. And like we have, you know, in the Caribbean islands, there's this very interesting chutney music that they have, where there is a fusion of an Indian and a Caribbean instrument. They played dholak and soca together to create chutney music. And if you read their writings, I truly want all of you to read a few of their work. This is very interesting. And when you read their work, when you read the Indo-African literature written by Indo-African Canadian writers, you'll see that there is a confluence of terms that is used. Sometimes there is a Hindi word coming up in English, in an English novel. Sometimes they would even use Swahili there. You know, the African dialect sometimes is put in place. And when you read the Indo-Caribbean writers, you see there is Creole English coming up again and again. When there is a dialogue that is produced in first person, you see that it is Creole English in which they talk about. So they have hyphenated identities, but are in between cultures. So they are Indo-African, Indo-Caribbean, but never Indian. Okay, so it is like a double consciousness, a double displacement that these people experience. And at their place of birth, they are displaced. So what happened when they were born? They were born not in India, but in another country. And that host country somewhere doesn't own them. Okay, so they were displaced at their place of birth also, because they had a status of outsider. So even if some of them had a secured childhood or youth, they were, you know, soon afterwards they were pushed to or they were forced to flee the country that they thought was their homeland. So they become an outsider, an immigrant there also. And after years of settlement and giving service to that country, they are displaced again. They are asked to move out of that country again. And they experience double displacement when they migrate to Canada, America, and England. The double displacement is also caused because they look Indian. In Canada, America, and in England, they are seen as Indians. Whereas, even though their names are Indian, some of their culture or their food habits and traditions, depict their Indianness, but they are not Indians. They are Indo-Caribbean or Indo-Africans. So it's very difficult for these writers or these people to explain to the Canadian population that they are not Indians, but hyphenated Indian, a kind of mixture of Indian and African culture or Indo and Caribbean culture. So their names, looks, culture, traditions are similar to Indians, but they can barely identify with Indians. The problem is also with them. Okay, they also do not find a sense of identification with Indians. When they try and mingle, when you read their literature, you see that they always, they find a kind of distance between Indians and Indo-African or Indo-Caribbean people. They are individuals who are generations away from their homeland, that was India. But their heritage gives them a consciousness of their past. Their heritage, their looks, their physical features somewhere, makes them conscious of their Indian past. And displacement is not just geographical, but social and cultural as well for all these people. I take here two very important writers to just give a feel of what this double displacement is about. Okay, there is Neil Bisundat, who's a nephew of V.S. Naipaul, and M.G. Vasanji, who we have from India, Indian-Canadian borders, from India, or who's an Indo-Kenyan writer. And both these writers have settled in Canada. They have been welcomed, they have been, their literature has been appreciated. They have won a number of awards, and the Canadian Multicultural Society has open-heartedly welcomed them. Yet, in their writings, we see not just once, but again and again, a sense of double displacement that comes out. And they have many works. They have more than 12 works. And Vasanji came up with, a 2020 or 19 work, that is The Delhi Obsession. Okay, so in both these writers, we see that this double displacement is there. You know, if you look at their writings, I've enlisted only a few. You see words like nostalgia, a place within, okay, in between, okay, on the eve of uncertain tomorrows. So all these things tell us about this insecurity that these writers go through. Why? Because of the identity crisis that they feel. Okay, these are the two writers. We have Vasanji and Neil Bisundat. Both have contributed a lot to the diaspora consciousness and by their writings. And they also have a number of essays that talks about the writings of diaspora. That helps us understand that these double diaspora writers cannot be clubbed with simple diaspora writers. People who have migrated for their own benefit, because these are people who were forced not from one land but from two countries. So there is double displacement. I'll briefly talk about two works. One, A Casual Brutality by Neil Bisundat, and The In-Between World of Vikram Lal by M.G. Vasanji. Both these novels have a lot of similarities. What we see is that, number one, the characters that the protagonists that we have in Casual Brutality, we have Raj Ram Singh. Once again, the name tells you that the person is of Indian origin. And in between world of Vikram Lal, we have Vikram Lal, once again, a descendant of the Indians settled in Africa. Okay, so we find a common factor where, there is Canada and there is Indian ancestry there. Okay, the common factor is also Canada, where which is the setting of the novel in both these novels. So what we see is that, these two characters have somehow moved to Canada because of various reasons, but then they always have a longing to go back to their homeland. Now, homeland for these people is not India. Homeland for Raj Ram Singh is a Caribbean island, and Bisundat has given a fictitious name to it, that is Kasakamida. And for Vikram Lal, Vasanji says homeland is Kenya, where he was born and brought up. Okay, Vikram Lal sees Kenya as a place where he belonged. He had flourished as a businessman there, and he had contributed in establishing, the first government after Kenyan independence. And he was a very powerful man till he was thrown out, till he became a scapegoat for all the politicians who put in all the corruption charges on him.
Ma'am, Urusi ma'am, can you hear us? Dear participant, there has been a net connectivity is unstable.
I call them. Just a
minute. Connected, sir, automatically.
Yes.
Dear participants, kindly hold on. Madam will get reconnected automatically. Yes sir, ma'am has come in.
Ma'am.
Yes ma'am, you are visible. You can chat from your side now.
Okay. Admin, can you share your the screen for me, my PPT? Do you have it right now?
Yes. Priya, are you there?
Okay. Priyadarshini, ma'am.
Yes. What's the slide number, ma'am? Can you see that?
Okay, just a second. I think I was... There's this problem with the window.
Priyadarshini, are you
there? Okay.
Just a minute.
Can you hear us?
Yeah, I think it is the second or third last slide. I'm nearing the end of my presentation. I don't know why there's this update problem coming up and I don't want to start it.
We can ignore that. Can you just share the screen again? You can ignore that update message.
Okay. Just a second. So it's covered the entire screen and not letting me do it.
Admin.
Yes, sir.
Admin, there is some problem in the internet from my side.
From?
Priyadarshini is not able to connect herself because of the instability of the net. Can you connect it from the base mail?
Hold on a minute, sir. Yes, sir.
Can
I'm
you
taking
please
it.
Take the base mail? Yes, please. Ma'am, 2 minutes.
Okay. I'm okay. Okay, I think I'm able to do it. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. Sorry, all right. So coming back to it, so we see that there is, both these characters have a sense of alienation in Canada, where they are, where they are settled, and they have a longing to go back to what they see as a place of birth or as their homeland. And towards the end of the novels, we see that both return home, but they face life-threatening violence, where Raj Ram Singh's Canadian wife and child is killed in a violent attack that takes place in Kasakibi dialect. And he has to return back home, return back to Canada. And so this longing for homeland that he had, for this Caribbean island that he has, ultimately, you know, takes him back home, but then the home rejects him. The homeland that he saw as a place where he could, you know, he could live, does not welcome him back. And he is, you know, he's forced to return back once again, but return without the family that he had. Similar is the case of Vikram Lal, where we see that Vikram Lal wants to return back to Kenya. He is not happy in Canada because he is in exile in Canada. He has, you know, he is asked to stay away from Kenya because of the political reasons. But then when he returns back home, he's hunted down like a criminal and he's killed. And he's killed there. So what we see is that these people, although with Indian identity, somewhere Indian hyphenated identity, saw you know, Caribbean island or Kenya as their homeland, but the homeland rejects them. So this whole concept of double displacement comes out very clearly in the writings of these two writers. I'm just naming you know, two works, but they are the other works. They have other works also, whether it is the short story or their novels. You see that this repeatedly comes out in their writings. Although what we see is that in Vasanti now there is this clear shift towards tracing roots in India. But with Bisundat, this is the trend, and he has again and again talked about double displacement. So they understand, you know, what we see is that they wanted to return to a homeland which doesn't welcome them. They cannot identify with India as a homeland, but then they carry a kind of, you know, hyphenated identity that somewhere includes India in their, you know, sense of place. To conclude, I would say the diaspora, you know, that we've read a lot about diaspora literature and their, you know, migration and how, you know, there are various writers like Chitra Banerjee or Bharati Mukherjee or Kiran Desai and all are writing about this diaspora consciousness. But it is through writers like Bisundat and Vasanji that we learn about the double diaspora. And these are people who were born in Africa or in Caribbean islands, but they look Indian. And when they move to Canada, they are seen as Indians, which creates a kind of clash of identity for them. And their characters are also in a state of flux, as home is linked to identity and their works negotiate variables of displacement. Okay, so it's difficult for them to find out what is home. And very interestingly, yesterday when I was just recalling what I have to speak here, I came across an interesting interview taken in 2020 of N.G. Vasanji, who very clearly said that, you know, identity needn't be, you know, a single, needn't be associated with a single place. It can be, you know, it can be in many places. And finally, you know, we see that even though the Canadian Multicultural Society accepts them and gives them a home, Bisundat clearly says that it is a boutique of showcase, a boutique to showcase different cultures, but also to segregate them. He doesn't accept it clearly. He doesn't call it his home. And he says that it is you know, simply a showcase for the world to see as to how different cultures can come together and live. But he says that it still segregates them, differentiates them. And in this differentiation, they are not able to find out whether they are Indians or Caribbeans. They are not able to find a clear foothold. And when we talk about Vasanji, in his essay also, he clearly is, in his one of his essays, he says that home is a continuous process. It is the search, the homelessness that provides momentum. So as a writer, he now doesn't want to say as to where his home is. And he is all right with the fact that he is a homeless person who's in continuous state of momentum, who's forever in movement and is looking for a home somewhere. So what is the future? How do we understand this whole double diaspora concept? I will borrow these ideas of Paul Gilroy, who said in his Black Atlantic, he said that it is better to focus more on the external routes that these people had taken. You know, that the path that these people have taken to understand their consciousness and their writings, rather than simply trying to find internal static roots of these people. And once again, to go back to 1990, where Stuart Hall has very clearly stated that diaspora identities are constantly producing, reproducing themselves anew through transformation and difference. So Stuart Hall also said that it is very difficult and it is not appropriate, like most of the concepts of post-colonial studies, to simply give it a very fixed and a very clear definition. And therefore, diaspora identities would also keep reproducing, transforming themselves. I'll end on the note that we have today a concept that is transnationalism that has come up, and especially where we have Stephen Vertebeck and Nina Glick-Schiller, who have elaborated on these concepts, which is once again a move away or a different transformed idea of diaspora, which believes that one can have transnational identity. Okay, so that could be the future of it. That could be another angle of tracing what diaspora or double diaspora could mean. Okay, so that is all that I had to say on double diaspora and double displacement. And these are the list of books I have referred to. Some of them I think I have not included, but mostly these were the books that I had taken the entire crux of this whole talk from. Okay. Thank you very much. And I hope, from diaspora to double diaspora, displacement to double displacement is a little clearer to the audience that is listening to. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. It is not little clear. It is very clear. It was like reading a short introduction to diasporic studies.
Okay.
It is very difficult to bring in all concepts together and introduce things, but you did it perfectly well. And one thing which you made very clear in your presentation was, usually in diaspora studies, we understand home as a land of, from where we or our ancestors came from.
Okay.
But then home is also an imagined community. That was very clear. Thank you so much. So we've actually had great responses in the chat box. So maybe I will share a few and then you would like to respond to it.
Yes.
We have Sangeeta R, who wants to know your ideas on, and she says, displacement takes place in the life of every woman. Are your views on it? And she wants you to relate it to Jhumpa Lahiri's The Namesake.
Okay. Obviously, if you've read Jhumpa Lahiri's The Namesake, you understand Ashima's displacement was also of a greater note. Okay, I feel, and I think it has come out very clearly in Chitra Banerjee's works also. If you've read some of them, you understand that, we can call women as double displaced there also. Although theoretically, I've not come across any of the great theorists talking about it. Maybe, if there is an angle of feminist diaspora or so, we can see that. But then I feel for a woman, the fact that a woman gets married, leaves home and moves to a different place altogether, it is a displacement. And once, like in the case of Ashima in The Namesake, all right, it is double displacement. Why? Because she's also leaving homeland and moving to another country altogether. So yes, definitely, by what we see is also, a double displacement that can be said. And yes, in Jhumpa Lahiri's Namesake, it comes out. But then it also comes out in Bharti Mukherjee's also. If Bharti Mukherjee's, I am forgetting the the name of that novel. But then, you know, there also that woman's quest is there. And, you know, in Shona Singh Baldwin's also writings, you see, you know, when there is a talk about a woman's migration after marriage, double diaspora or, you know, double displacement is very obviously there.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. We have Dr. A. Rajeshwar Pushpam asking you, how can we consider these diasporan portrayal of their lost homeland as authentic or genuine? Because they themselves belong to a hybrid world. Of course, you have mentioned this.
Yes.
Because you've said how, you know, how the response is more, they're charged with commercialism. But then you can also respond.
Okay. Thank you so much for, you know, you remember everything that I said. Okay. All right. Yes. You know, they very truly said, and even I read a book, and that is by Shona Singh Baldwin, The Selector of Souls. I want you know, people to read that novel. Somewhere, you know, even though I'm a fan of Salman Rushdie, and I you know, in spite of all that sometimes negative portrayal also of the homeland, I still agree to what Rushdie or maybe Rohingtan Mystery or the other writers have projected. But I have a problem, of the projection or delineation of homeland by some of these writers, like Shona Singh Baldwin's recent work, where it seems as if she has simply picked up all political problems of India and have woven a story around it, trying to connect. So yes, very true. And there is this recent whole group of researchers, and that is talking about how this whole perspective of writing about homeland from a distance is being commercialized. And like I said, you have, sometimes when you pick up a writer, you don't find any merit in their writing. Yet you see that they have been published by some great foreign publication house. Why? Because they say that they are talking about homeland. Okay, so there, the authenticity or, the honesty with which they convey the picture of homeland is, it can definitely be questioned, and I feel that should be questioned by we as Indian scholars. And I feel, therefore, I want to go back again and again. And I feel, Salman Rushdie made himself safer when he said that it is the imaginary homelands that we are creating. And he didn't say that this is exactly what India is. But sometimes when you listen to these young authors and when you listen to their interviews, they talk about their homeland as if they know everything, whereas we who live in India would clearly disagree to their viewpoint and perspective of the nation. So therefore, yes, it has to be questioned, and I feel that as literature gives us an ability to question and to read any writing from different viewpoints, I think these diaspora writers also and their works also can be read again with a critical perspective, and we as Indians or people, not just in India, you know, the Pakistanis living in, Pakistanis can review the writings of their diaspora writers or, Sri Lankan or any other country, okay, can review it. And I think that needs to be done. And there can be, nobody can say that their picture is clearly authentic. You can read, and sometimes you can question them sometimes. And most of the time, I even disagreed to, Vikram Seth's that huge, I think 30 pages long description of Holi and the riots taking place. We don't see Holi like that. Okay, so therefore, sometimes I think that these writers commercialize small events in order to gain get more of or attract more of Western readership and Western publication houses. So therefore, nobody can guarantee that it's a very authentic picture that they draw. So I clearly agree to you. There is a question mark there.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. So we have Ms. Rohini asking you, can we call migrant workers traveling from one state to another within a country as diasporic community?
Oh yes. Oh, you know, they are called insiders, or right, or migrants. Migrants workers are, you know, insider nation also. Although I've not come across any particular theory that talks about, you know, diasporas created in, you know, in the country itself. But see, look. Most of us are, like I am, I belong to UP and now I'm settled in Gujarat. Okay, so I call myself a diaspora here, because there are times that I do not connect with the, you know, the Gujarati way of life that I see around myself. I am also a living example of living here and desiring there. Okay, so I keep looking back at my homeland in Agra and I keep thinking about, you know, what were the ways there. Whether it is sometimes food, there's sometimes traditions, you know, I also have a problem with that. So it's not just the migrant workers who can be called as diaspora. I think anybody, you know, anybody who has left, and especially when, you know, when you talk about a country like India, that is immensely multicultural. There are so many cultures. Obviously, you know, when you move away from your culture to another place that has another culture, then, you know, you are a diaspora. Okay, if I come and live in Tamil Nadu with you all, I will again be diaspora. Okay, because I will have my own culture and I will try and understand your culture once again. So that will always be there. And there may be some writers who may have talked about it, but you know, unfortunately, I've not read about it. But I honestly feel that inside a country also diasporas are created.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. And then Ms. Anu Sebastian wants to know whether these terms, refugee writing, exile writing, migrant writing, do all these come under the umbrella term diaspora literature?
Yes, they all come, maybe, you know, with a little difference. Like you have refugee writing, so then, you know, they will be, I think, more towards exile. Okay, as to how they had to run away. They in their writings, violence would be a more common streak that one would see. Whereas when you talk about, you know, the current diaspora writers of, you know, group of people who have simply moved away for better life opportunities, you don't see that struggle, that violence or loss in their writings. But then under this huge umbrella of diaspora literature, all these come. And we can include them, because deep down I feel that there is a lot of common factors in all these writings.
Okay, ma'am, thank you. Ma'am, a couple of questions more. Is there a term tribal diaspora? Because Ms. Neeraja Gopalakrishnan wants to know if she can have some reference books to be mentioned from you on tribal diaspora.
No, I'm sorry, Ms. Neerja, but I have not come across and I have not seen about tribal diaspora.
Tribal.
Okay, if I ever come across, I will, you know, I'll probably let you know. Okay, and I have not read about it and I've not heard about it. It must be, if it is there, let me find out and get back to you.
Thank you, ma'am. And Mr. Kadiravan Annamalai, he wants to know, actually, this would actually be a summary of your lecture if you're going to answer it. What kind of difference can we see in the sense of nostalgia and alienation in the writings of forced migrators and voluntary migrators?
Okay. Post-migrators and voluntary migrators. I'll talk about Vijay Mishra's essay here. Vijay Mishra very clearly talks about two diasporas. He says old diaspora and new diaspora. Like you have, you know, he's given a term, post-migrants and early migrants. So what we see, you know, the old diaspora was a community that was taken away from their homeland. And the new diaspora is a community that has voluntarily moved out of homeland for, you know, whatever reasons. So we have these two communities. And the nostalgia in them obviously is different, because we are talking about post, you know, I'm sorry, can you give me those terms again that he used? Post?
He says forced migrators and voluntary migrators.
No.
Maybe he's referring to, you know, people who go settle there voluntarily, and then maybe the ones who are captured and arrested and, you know, taken as us. Maybe that is what.
So obviously people who were forced, who were who were involuntarily taken out because of some because of some problems they had to move out of homeland. We are talking about a community, and we are talking about an age where there weren't so many means of communication available to them. So therefore, their sense of nostalgia is extremely great. And they have a longing for homeland. Whereas when we talk about voluntary migration, where we talk about people who have moved voluntarily, we are talking about, if we talk about, say, 1970s onwards, when there was this huge, trend of Indians going to America and creating Silicon Valley there, you understand that these people could very easily communicate and still be in touch with the homeland and yet be a part of a different nation. So, and they could come back home maybe every year also. So therefore, for them, nostalgia is yes, an emotion, but I feel that it's not as great as those illiterate indentured laborers, laborers who were forced to leave their homeland and could never find a way to even communicate with their relatives and people in the homeland. So therefore, the sense of nostalgia is definitely different. And it is also different in the first and the second generation of these migrant communities that you see. The first generation has an extreme sense of nostalgia, homelessness, and a longing memory of homeland. But the second generation is not so, troubled by a longing for homeland. They find their sense of identity more in the hyphens that is created in the hostland that they live in. So therefore, their nostalgia is also different. So for every, there can be many fractions of diaspora, and everything has to be studied in context. And we cannot just say that this has more nostalgia or that has more nostalgia. But yes, what the question was, I would say that yes, there is a clear difference also because of their education, the conditions in which they had to migrate, and the resources that was available to them. So considering all these three things, their nostalgia, was greater, and it, their longing was greater than what we see today in the, in the current diaspora people. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. We do have a couple of questions, but then for time's sake, we'll just wind up the session. Yeah. But then I'm getting a lot of responses which say, well-structured, well-organized, very well-presented.
Thank you so much.
That's what we all feel. Thank you so much.
I was really worried, that I was taking so many things. I thought that, people who are listening would be able to get the flow of thoughts.
No, because
but I've heard such great speakers on your platform that, I thought that let me just do a little bit like they do here. Okay. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Okay. And I look forward to more association with all of you there. Thank you, all of you. Okay, thank Dr. Vimla, Dr. Ramasubhaiya, Anna, thank you for giving me another.
Thank you, thank you.
And Dr. Supla for listening to every word, if I clearly.
Pleasure. It was great. And it was so well structured that you cannot miss out anything.
Thank God. Okay.
Very good.
Thank you coming from you. And thank you to all the participants who were, who were patiently listening and following my ideas. Thank you. And I hope that we get to meet someday. And last but not the least, thank you, admin. Thank you, Sudhakar, for helping me out. Okay. That's okay. All right.
Thank you, ma'am. I'll come back to you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you. So, dear participants, please join us at 2:40 and we'll start the session exactly at 3 o'clock. As I told you that we have a more enlightening and enchanting session in the afternoon. And followed by the session, we have a valedictory, and we have scheduled it at 4:30. So, I request to all the participants to join us a little earlier. And also, please, this is a request to all of you, please stay connected, stay tuned to us till 5 o'clock. We have planned to have this voluntary session for half an hour. We have invited, we have circulated the invitation, and we have invited two eminent personalities. They will address you, and shortly we'll close the welcome session at 5 o'clock. Thank you so much. And we have also, we have got some instructions also, and that I will announce it at the end of the validity session. Thank you so much. We'll join you after the lunch. Admin?
All.